Praise the Lord. Please be seated if you would. We welcome you to Jesus Lord Outreach Center. Glad that you are here this evening. Praise the Lord. We always like to greet those that are here for the first time. If you're first time here, would you raise your hand? Praise God. Hallelujah. We have a gentleman here. We have a woman over there. We welcome you. We're glad that you've come. Praise God. You got the good news for you? Did you get a good news for you? Did somebody give you the good? Praise God. Hope you take the time to read it. A 12-page publication, sharing the gospel of salvation, receiving the Holy Spirit, healing, deliverance, and testimonies of victory, and exhorting us to walk in the way of the Lord so we can possess the promises of God in our life. We're going to receive our offering as we bring up our tithes and offerings unto Him. Heavenly Father, we thank You and praise You for the opportunity to bring up tithes and offerings to You. We give freely, we give excitedly, we give because we want to, we give joyously. We know that as we bring them, we know that You rebuke the devourer for our sakes. You open the windows of heaven, pour out Your blessings upon us. We thank You that Your blessings are resting upon our house. And we thank You that You are causing all grace to abound toward us, that we have all sufficiency in all things and may be able to abound to every good work. Father, thank You for meeting the need of every individual in this place according to Your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, please wait on the people if you would. Our regular service times are Sunday morning at 10, Sunday evening at 6:30, Wednesday, 7 o'clock, and we also have prayer meeting, intercessory prayer, on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. We also have on Friday nights people going out in evangelistic teams to share the gospel on the street, and pass out the good news for you, and talking to people about the Lord. On Saturday, we have our deliverance, ministering deliverance on an ongoing basis to help you to be set free from bondages. And we also, of course, make a first-time appointment with those who are interested in receiving deliverance so we can sit down, talk with you, explain it to you in a confidential appointment, going over the problem areas in your life and begin to minister to them directly one-on-one. Praise God for what He's doing as people are taking hold of the Word and walking in it and seeing God bring forth victory. Praise God. Hallelujah. We're going to pray for all men, and then we're going to pray for our nation before we get into the Word this evening. Agree with me if you would. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank You and we praise You as we pray for every person who has never received Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. We thank You that You desire for all to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. You don't want any to perish. Father, we just pray, the Lord of the harvest, thank You for sending forth those laborers to go forth and preach the gospel boldly as they ought. Thank You that as the gospel is being preached in the hearts of the people throughout the world, thank You that You're opening the eyes of their understanding. Thank You for the word sown in their heart. Thank You for bringing the revelation that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, the only way of being reconciled unto the Father. Father, thank You for the Holy Spirit working to convict them of the sin of not believing on Jesus. Thank You for bringing them to the place of repentance. And Father, we thank You for multitudes receiving Jesus and being born again. We will be witnesses and we will go forth and preach the gospel and pass out tracts, pass out the gospel so that others can know the truth and can be born again. Now, Father, we also pray for this nation. Father, we see the workings that are evil in our nation. We see the workings of lawlessness. We see the workings of unrighteousness. We see the workings of the devil, Antichrist spirits against the church. We see the spirits that are trying to destroy the sovereignty of this nation and to bring it into a one new world order. We see all the activities that are going on. Father, we thank You that our warfare is not against flesh and blood, but it's against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness, against the spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places. And we thank You that You've set us over the kingdoms and over the nations, and You've told us that we are to bind them. So we bind all of these spirits in the name of Jesus. We loose and untie their hold, and we cast them down, throw them down, root them out, and destroy their works over this nation, over this government, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank You for sending forth Your warring angels, doing battle in the Spirit, destroying the works of these enemies. Father, we thank You for bringing those rulers to the place of repentance or removing them from office. Father, we thank You for doing whatever is necessary to overthrow the works of the enemy in this nation. Father, we thank You. So we look to You, and we know that You are mighty, and we thank You for Your great wisdom And we thank you for shaking this nation and doing whatever is necessary to bring it to repentance and restore it to righteousness. Thank you that we are one nation under God. And Father, we just rejoice and we praise you that your word is true. And we do stand in the gap, remitting the sins and iniquities of this of the nation from its founding to this moment. And as we do so, we know that you're causing all grace to abound towards this nation. Pour it out on this nation. Thank you that we are your people who are called by your name. Humble ourselves, pray. We seek your face. We turn from our wicked ways. We pray continuously. We thank you that you hear from heaven. We thank you that you forgive us our sins. Thank you for your grace, your mercy, your love and action going forth to heal and restore this land. Thank you, Father, for restoring it to righteousness. We praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God for what God is doing. Hallelujah. Please stand with me if you would. We're going to pray as we get into God's word this evening. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you and we praise you for your word, which is the truth. We receive your word written in our heart, written in our mind. We thank you for the revelation of it. We will be hearers and doers of it. We praise you for all that you bring forth. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated if you would. We are sharing with you on the subject of accurate New Testament prayer, a very important subject for every one of us to understand. I see that we have some people that are here new and some people that may not have heard what we've talked about thus far, so we're going to try to catch you up. We have seen the fact that prayer has changed from Old Testament to New Testament. That is a very important thing for you to understand. In the Old Testament, they were not born again. They were not redeemed. They were not priests. All of them were not priests. They couldn't come into the presence of God. The way in the holiest was not open to all. They had a very limited approach to God, only through the one tribe, the tribe of Levi, that were priests. They were not born again. They were not sons and daughters. God was not their heavenly Father. They used to pray by asking, requesting, petitioning, asking Him to give ear to their supplication, not hide from what they would bring forth, listen to their prayer and give ear. They had no confidence of what God was going to do. They were basically at His mercy. That's the way they prayed in the Old Testament. But there was a new day. It is the New Testament. The New Testament now, there has been a change in prayer, and that is very important. When we pray, we are communicating with God in the Spirit according to His Word. As we are doing it, we are putting His spiritual laws into operation and releasing the spiritual promises that have already been given to us to come into manifestation in our life. We're also putting the power of God that's resident in His Word into operation to not only bring promises, but also to defeat the enemy in our life. We must realize that there is a change. How do we pray in the New Testament now? We now are born again. We're children of God. We now have a relationship to God as our Heavenly Father. So we now pray to our Heavenly Father. Jesus now has a ministry at the right hand of the Father. He is the high priest over this covenant. He is the one who, when we do everything in the New Testament, we always do it in the name of Jesus. When we do things in the name of Jesus, we're coming through the high priestly ministry of Jesus Christ. Now, in John chapter 16, verse 23, we've seen something very important. He says, in that day, Jesus is doing the speaking, talking about the day after the resurrection, you shall ask me nothing. That tells you that you don't pray to Jesus. You're not going to ask Jesus anything. It's a new day. What are we going to do now? He says, verily, verily, I say unto whatsoever you shall ask the Father. We're now going to pray directly to the Father in my name. Therefore, we're not going to pray to Jesus. There's lots and lots of people, lots of ministers even, that are praying to Jesus. Is it in line with the Word? No. Jesus, out of His own mouth, said, don't be coming to me. Don't be asking anything of me. Now we pray to the Father in the name of Jesus because of His high priestly ministry. Now, it's also important that we do, the way we approach Him now is different in trying, in wanting to see Him respond to the things that we pray. It's also the way we pray is now totally different. We must understand that all the words that we see in the English version, they're not always translated correctly, unfortunately. We see in this verse two words for ask. If you notice, in that day you shall ask me nothing. And then whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he'll give it you. When we look up the first word, ask, and I put the cursor over it, you'll notice that it is number 2065, a Greek word, erateo. And to show you what this meaning is exactly, because the Bible Works has lots, it's a good program for showing a lot of things, but they have a lot of mistakes on their meanings. You have to look very closely when you're looking at their meanings. When we go over to Strong's Concordance, it tells us what this word means. This is Strong's Concordance reproduced. This is the dictionary, the Greek dictionary, reproduced in the Lightning Bible program. Remember, the number was 2065, erateo. What does this word mean? It means properly, means a request as a favor. A request as a favor. If we go back here, we say that Jesus said, in that day you shall request as a favor of me nothing. That's the way they prayed in the Old Testament, requesting of a favor. Now he says, verily, verily, I say unto whatsoever you shall ask the Father. What's this word ask? Is it the same word? No, it's a different word. It is a Greek word, number 154. This is keyed to Strong's Concordance, aiteo. What does this word specifically mean? When we look in, again, the Lightning Bible program, and we see Strong's here, and this is a, if you look this up in Strong's, this is a comparison of similar words to give you exact definitions of what it is. We come to number 154, if you see my cursor going over 154, which means strictly a demand of something due. A demand of something due. That's what the word means. And this is the word that is used in all the major prayer scriptures throughout the New Testament, as we have seen. We took the time on Sunday morning to go through scripture after scripture after scripture of use all the prayer scriptures and saw that aiteo was used in all of these major prayer scriptures in the New Testament. Whatsoever you shall make a demand of what is due you of the Father, in my name, he will give it you. Why are we making a demand of something that's due us? First, we've got to realize that means something is due us. What's due us? Anything that you and I have done to cause it? No. It's what God has done. And what has God done? What is due us? Well, we know that what Jesus Christ, of course, brought forth the new covenant that you and I come into and were born again. In 2 Corinthians 1:20, it says, for all the promises of God in him are yea, yes, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by us. That means all the promises of God have already been given to us. They're yes. Another scripture that's important to see is Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, which says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us, that's past tense, with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Hath blessed us, that is past tense. That means the blessings of God, the promises of God, as we've already seen in the other verse, have already been given to us. If they've already been given to us by the Lord, then what does that mean? That means now that they are due us because God has given them to us. They've already been credited to our account, so to speak. They've already been given to us according to the New Testament. So, what are we going to do in order to release these promises that have already been given to us, that are already due us? We're going to make a demand. Now, what is this demand all about? It is not demanding of God, trying to make God do something. You don't demand anything of God. He's God. You don't get him. You don't make him do anything that he doesn't want to do or hasn't already done or has already told us something that we're to do. Demand is a legal term. We are making a demand according to spiritual law, which is all the things we see in the New Testament, the covenant promises that are already given to us. We're making a spiritual legal demand of the Father in my name, and he, the Father, will give it you. How do we make a spiritual legal demand of the promises that are due us? We bring the scripture promise that is declared in the New Testament that belongs to us. For instance, in the area of healing, by whose stripes you were healed, speaking of what Jesus did on the cross, took away the sickness and disease, healing now has been given unto us, by whose stripes you were healed is a promise. All the past tense scriptures that you see about things that He's given to us are promises of God. We now have obtained mercy, 1 Peter 2:10. That's a promise. Mercy belongs to us legally as a promise of God, and so we bring the Scripture promise unto Him. When we bring the Scripture promise to Him, which is that which belongs to us, that's due us, that is one aspect of what we're doing. And the reason we're bringing that to Him is because that all the promises are ours, and we're coming to receive them through New Testament prayer. And when we do that, we should bring the specific promises that we are bringing to Him. So we're going to bring the specific Scriptures that give us the specific promise that belongs to us. Now, he goes on and he says, "Hitherto," which means up to this time, "have you," and the word "ask you" twice from this verse is also aiteo, "made a demand of what's due you." Up to this time, have you made it? You've not made a demand of what's due you of nothing in my name. Why is that? Because the New Testament wasn't in force yet. Jesus is talking prior to the New Testament, but he's teaching New Testament prayer that's going to come into manifestation after the resurrection and the New Testament came into being. So he says, up to this time, you have made a demand of what's due you of nothing in my name. Make a demand of what's due you, aiteo. And this is actually a commanding statement that's made to us. It is an imperative mood verb. The imperative mood means a command. It's a command. Whatever the imperative mood says in a command, you and I must do it. So, make a demand of what's due you. And how do we do that? By bringing the Scripture promise to Him. And you shall receive that your joy may be full. That brings us to a second point, which we've covered. And that is that what the word receive means. There are two major words for receive in the New Testament. One of them is a word dekamai, which means a passive reception. I'm waiting for something, ready to accept something that comes to me. The other word is lambano, which is the opposite. It is an active reception where I'm taking hold of something. Now, when it says you shall receive, we need to know. Now we're supposed to make this demand of what's due us by bringing the Scripture promise of the Father in the name of Jesus, and that's just presenting that of what the promise is to Him. So how are we going to release this promise? Are we going to wait for it, or are we supposed to do something else? It is the Greek word lambano, which means to take hold of. Therefore, you are going to take hold of that promise actively to release that to come into manifestation in your life. How do I take hold of something? I can't grab it. It's spiritual. I do it with my mouth. The way you receive everything from God is through your mouth. When you got born again, John 1, verse 12, as many as received Him. In fact, the word is lambano. As many as received Him. You notice this word in the lower window. I'm talking about lambano. For you who are here for the first time, there's information in the lower window about the word that we put the cursor over. As many as received Him, we took Him as our Savior. To them gave He the power to become the sons of God, even those that believe on His name. When you receive the Holy Spirit, it's the same thing. You receive the Holy Spirit to come and dwell in you. Everything that you get is you receive the promises of God. When you pray the prayer of faith, you believe that you receive those promises that you have brought before the Lord. So this is very important that we understand that now we are going to pray in the New Testament the Scripture promises. That means we don't pray the problem. We pray the word, the promises. And then we take hold of those promises with our faith, speaking it into being, to take hold of that, to release that, to come into manifestation in our life. Who's going to give it to us? The Father is going to give it to us. And as you take hold of it, your joy may be full. We took the time and we saw all these scriptures that used aiteo, a demand to what's due you, and receive, lambano, taking hold of the promises of God. We also talked about thanksgiving, how we pray with thanksgiving always. When we pray with thanksgiving, we are always approaching God in that way. And why are we approaching Him with thanksgiving? Because all the promises have already been given to us. When we come And we come in faith to receive the promises. The Bible says we're rooted and built up in Him in Colossians 2:7, established in the faith as you've been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. When we pray with thanksgiving. We even see when Jesus was praying in John chapter 11, how would He begin to pray? He would pray with thanksgiving. He said, Father, I thank Thee that Thou hast heard me. We see that they were praying with thanksgiving. When you pray with thanksgiving, the reason we do that is because the promises have already been given to us. When we come to the Father in the name of Jesus and present the Scripture-specific promise, and we do that, we believe we take hold of it with thanksgiving. Why? Because the promise is already given to us. Would we ask Him to give us the promise after He already gave it to us? No. He already gave it to us. He says, come and take hold of that promise. So what are we going to do? Thank You as I take hold of that promise. That's why you do it with thanksgiving. This is the way we pray in the New Testament, showing that we are going to take hold of the promises of God with thanksgiving. Also, we talked about the fact that we pray continuously and repeatedly until we see the desired results, and that is so important. And these are critical things that we're going over for you who were not here, but also for you who were here. It's important to get these principles established in you. Mark 11:24. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe you receive them, and you shall have them. The word desire is not the word normally for desire. That would mean like what I wish or what I want. It's the same word, aiteo, number 154, in all these prayer scriptures. What things soever you make a demand to what's due you, when you pray, believe, and they're always aiteo and lambano, believe that you lambano, take hold of that, and you shall have them. This is known as the prayer of faith. Do we pray the prayer of faith one time, or do we pray it more than once? That has been quite a matter of debate in the body of Christ. There is people that are of a word of faith persuasion that teach that you only pray one time. If you pray more than one time, you must have been in doubt and unbelief. Why would you pray again? If you prayed and God heard you, it's just going to happen. No, we pray continuously. How do we know it? Because we can look up the tenses. When we look at this word, aiteo here, that was translated desire, we find that it's in the present tense. The tenses are important. If you're here for the first time, don't be overwhelmed by us bringing this up if you've never even heard this before. The present tense means continuous ongoing action. And that's important. Because if something's in the present tense, that means we're supposed to do it continuously and repeat it ongoing until we saw results. That's why it's the present tense. When you pray, it's also in the present tense. Ongoing action, praying continually. The word believe is also in the present tense, as we see, and it has also the imperative mood, which means you're commanded to believe that you receive, that you take hold of it. Notice, remember we were commanded to make a demand of what's due you? We're also commanded to believe we take hold of a promise. The word receive, lambano, is also the present tense. So we pray continuously without ceasing. We even know that it's clear as a bell when you look at scriptures such as 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17. Pray without ceasing. That pretty much says it. We pray continuously until we see the desired results. Every time you pray, you are putting your faith in operation as you're taking hold of the promise and you believe you receive it with thanksgiving and you speak it into being, you are putting your faith in operation to see that promise come to pass in your life. And that is so important. So we now pray to the Father in the name of Jesus. We make a spiritual legal demand of what's due us by bringing the specific scripture promise. We believe that we take hold of that to release that promise that's already been given to us as a covenant promise to bring it into being and into manifestation in our life. We talked about some other things of where we make strong desire with the idea of urgent need. We also pray with confidence and persistency and stretching ourselves out many other scriptures that we saw, which we're not going to go over tonight, they were covered prior to this in the way that we pray. But the critical things that you must understand, New Testament prayer is different from Old Testament prayer. Do not pray in an Old Testament way. Pray to the Father in the name of Jesus. Don't pray the problem. That doesn't make anything happen. Pray the answer, which is the scripture promise that you're taking hold of, which is going to bring forth the manifestation of the promise of God in your life. And pray it continuously until you see the desired results. Now, tonight, we're going to go into another area about prayer, and this is not praying to the Father. This is now we're going to talk about prayers of authority, which are also important, because we need to learn how to pray with all manner of prayer effectively. Some people say, well, if I just pray to the Father, and isn't everything going to be taken care of? No, because no, there's prayers of authority that you and I must pray to deal successfully with the enemy. And who's our enemy? Satan. He is the adversary. In fact, we look over in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. The devil's very active. He's trying to devour you. He's trying to hinder you. He's trying to bring destructive things against you. Well, we also see in John 10, it shows what the enemy does, and of course it tells you what the Lord will do. John 10:10, the thief cometh not, but for to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. All of the stealing, killing, and destruction in any aspect in your life, physically, mentally, financially, socially, wherever it might be, it's been a work of the devil. God doesn't bring those things to pass. This is a work of the enemy. So, we must understand that we have an enemy, and how are we going to defeat him? It's also going to be through prayer, but it's going to be through prayers of authority. Now, one thing you must understand, when you got born again, what happened to you? Not only did you get a new spirit, the spirit of Jesus Christ, but something happened to you because you were formerly under Satan's dominion. We all were under his dominion until we received Jesus, got born again, and came out from that. Colossians 1:13 tells us something important. Speaking of what Jesus did, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. The word power is a Greek word exousia, which means authority. Young's corrects the King James error. This is Young's literal translation that we put up, the best translation that I know of in the New Testament today, where it translates this correctly, authority. God delivered us from the authority of darkness, and he's translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. You and I have come into the position of being in the kingdom. And we must understand that when you receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, we see verse 5 and 6 of Revelation 1. Verse 5 says, from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the first begotten of the dead, the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our own sin and his own blood. We've been born again. Our sins are now washed away. We come into relationship with him. What else did he do? He hath made us kings and priests unto God. You're a priest now that you can approach God freely and have come into fellowship with him, praise and worship him, come and pray to take hold of the promises as we've been talking about. But you're also a king. Jesus is the King of kings. You and I are the kings that he is the king of. He has made you a king now. What do kings do? They're to rule and to reign. We see this over in Romans chapter 5. Now you and I are to rule and reign. And who do we rule and reign over? Our spiritual enemy, who is Satan, and all the evil spirits working for him. Romans 5:17. For by one man's offense death reigned by one, that was through Adam's sin. Much more, those that receive or take hold of the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. You and I can reign. We can reign. We can rule in life through Jesus Christ, and we can rule and reign over our enemies. Now, you do need to understand as a king that you are now, as it says in 1 Peter chapter 2, in verse 9, It declares that you and I are now a royal priest. You're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. There's a twofold priesthood, a holy priesthood. Now we're a priest. We can offer up sacrifices to God, come into Him, presence of God, praise and worship Him, pray, take hold of the promises. But now you're a royal priesthood. That's a kingly priesthood. You now can rule and reign over every enemy in your life. How are you going to be able to do that? Well, God's given you authority. In Luke chapter 10, we see in verse 19, He says this, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." We need to look at these words first to see what's really being said. The first word, power, again, is this word exousia, which means authority. Translated authority correctly by Young's. The second word, power, if you notice, is a different word in the Greek. It's the word dunamis. The word dunamis truly does mean power. So this is saying, I've given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. That tells you, do you have authority that can stop the power of the enemy? Now, that also tells you the enemy has power. And that's a significant thing. Some people think, well, the enemy can't do anything. Not so. He has power. So you have authority over the power of the enemy, that when you put your authority in operation, you can stop the power of the enemy, and you're going to do it through different prayers of authority. Now, another thing we need to comment on here for a moment, where it says, nothing shall by any means hurt you. Many people have thought of this as a confession statement, just a factual statement, the whole verse. The whole verse making a statement. I've given you authority over to tread on serpents, over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. There's a flat statement as a truth. It's not. It's a conditional statement, the last part is. It's conditional upon you doing what is necessary to stop the power of the enemy, which is use your authority against him. How do we know it's a conditional statement and not just something that would be a statement of fact that you could just speak and just declare it and then it would happen? See, many people have thought, if I just confess this word, then nothing will hurt me because I've got this word. It's a fact. It's not a fact. How do we know? Because you have to look up the verbs. When we look up this word, hurt, we find that this is a subjunctive mood verb. Now, for you again here for the first time, we explain this thoroughly, and it's very important to understand this. There are five moods in the Greek. The mood of reality, or the mood of factual statement, is called the indicative mood. So used some 15,000 times in the New Testament. The subjunctive mood is a different mood that we see here. The subjunctive mood is a mood that is expressing things that are contrary to fact, that are conditional upon conditions being met. In other words, nothing shall by any means hurt you is conditional upon conditions being met. It's not a fact. It can, of course, be manifest, but it's conditional. So what is it saying? God's given us authority to tread upon serpents, scorpions, over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt us if we meet the conditions of doing what? Using our authority to stop the power of the enemy. It's not just confessing a verse, it's putting the authority into operation to stop the power of the enemy. And that is absolutely essential to understand. So that means you got to learn to pray prayers of authority. If you don't learn how to pray prayers of authority, how are you going to stop the power of the enemy? And the enemy's doing all kinds of things to people. Just go to the hospitals and they're full of sickness, all types of people that are bound by the enemy. Go to the other places where, you know, mental facilities, they are just full of people that are all bound by the enemy in their mind. So the power of the enemy is definitely evident. He's causing all of these kinds of problems. Now, in order for you to pray prayers of authority, you must understand that you are an heir of the kingdom. You've come into relationship with the Father through Jesus Christ. You are now a son of God or a daughter of God. And the Bible says if you're a son, then you're an heir of God. In fact, in Romans 8, it says we're a joint heir with Christ. And here it speaks of the fact that He's chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, and heirs of the kingdom. You are an heir of the kingdom. The kingdom is the rule and the reign of God. You're now a king in the kingdom. which he hath promised to them that love him. Now that does tell us something. This inheritance of the rule and reign of God doesn't automatically work for you unless you meet the conditions. Who's it for? Them that love him. Who are the ones that love him? The ones who keep his commandments and do the things he says. That means if you're walking in sin, are you going to be able to operate in the kingdom and rule and reign over your enemies? No, because you're giving place to him. You must be walking in the commandments of God and being obedient to him and have dealt with your sins, confessed them, so you're right with him, so that then you can operate in the kingdom. But it is part of your inheritance that belongs to you. Now, in order to operate in these prayers of authority, we got to find out what they are, and we got to understand about the kingdom. Matthew 6:33 says something important. Remember, we already saw the scripture in Colossians 1:13 that said we've been delivered out of the authority of darkness and we've been translated into the kingdom. If I've been translated into the kingdom, that means I'm in the position to rule and reign. But does that mean I'm ruling and reigning? No. I got to learn about this rule and reign. I got to get the understanding of it. And what am I going to do? Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness." We're going to seek the rule and the reign of God. We're going to learn about the rule and the reign of God, how it operates, so you and I can begin to function in ruling and reigning over our enemies, and that's important. We also see in Luke that the Father wants this for you. In fact, in Luke chapter 12, we see in verse 31 and 32, he says, "Rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." It's our Father's good pleasure to give us the rule and the reign of God. He wants us to rule and reign. So we're to seek after this rule and reign. How are we going to be able to do that? How do we find everything out? Through the Word of God. And we see in Matthew chapter 13, we see in verse 11, he talks about how it's given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. They're spiritual mysteries that are revealed to us by the Holy Spirit, and he wants us to know all these mysteries of the kingdom. And how are we going to know it? Well, verse 19 says, "When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom." So how are you going to learn about the kingdom? You're going to hear the word of the kingdom. The word of God is going to reveal the ways of the kingdom. It's going to reveal the rule and reign of God and how you operate in the kingdom so you can rule and reign over all of your enemies. And that is important. Another thing that we must understand, when you are going to enter into this, once you learn your authority, you have to know that. You have to know your weapons of warfare, which is the name of Jesus and the word of God. You're going to speak the word, and you're going to use the name of Jesus, which has given you authority over all of the power of the enemy as you speak forth, releasing that authority, and you're going to destroy the works of the enemy and stop the works of Satan and all his evil spirits. But one thing we need to realize, in Luke 16, verse 16, it says this, "The law and the prophets were until John." That's the Old Testament era. "Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached." That's about the New Testament era. "And every man," that would include every one of us, "presseth into it." "Presseth" is a Greek word, biazo. You notice below. This means to apply force, to force and inflict violence on. That means you are going to use force and violence, spiritual force and violence, to enter into it, which is the kingdom, the rule, and the reign of God. You mean I'm going to use spiritual force and violence and fight against something? That's right. You're going to use the spiritual force and violence of God that he's given unto you, and you are going to fight against the enemy, and you're going to conquer him, and you're going to enter into the rule and the reign of God. That means we're not going to be passive. We're going to be aggressive. We're going to be aggressive in warfare. We're going to be aggressive against the devil, using spiritual force and violence to destroy his works. At the same time, is the devil just going to lie down and give up and say, "Okay, I'll get out of your life and not cause any problems"? No, he's going to fight to the end. Acts 14:22 says, "Confirming the souls of the disciples, exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must, through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. You say, well, I thought I was already brought into the kingdom of God. You got to understand what the scriptures are saying. When it says we've been translated into the kingdom, that means we're in the position to rule and reign. When this is talking about you entering into the kingdom, it's talking about experientially in your life entering into the rule and the reign of God, conquering your enemies. And notice he says you must. That means it's mandatory, it's necessary. Through much tribulation, the word tribulation means pressure. You're going to have pressure that comes against you. Who's going to press you? The devil, trying to get you to not use your authority, trying to get you to back off from coming against him, trying to stop you every step of the way from destroying all of his works in your life. You're going to go through much. Why? Because every step that you take to drive out the enemy, he's going to try to resist. But notice, it doesn't say he's going to overcome you. You're going to go through that pressure as you enter into the rule and the reign of God. See, the devil has power, remember, and he's able to resist. And therefore, you're going to use spiritual force and violence, authority and power, the name of Jesus, the weapons of warfare that are going to conquer the enemy. And you're going to go through that pressure that comes against you. And you're going to enter into the rule and the reign of God in your life. You're going to do the mighty works of God. It means we can destroy every work of the enemy in our life. Mark chapter 13, verse 34. It's interesting here, it speaks here, the Son of Man is a man as a man taking a far journey who left his house. Who is the Son of Man? That was Jesus coming to pay the price for sin, walk the walk that Adam had failed, and accomplish the redemption. And now he left his house. Who's his house? The church. We are. Remember, he's the cornerstone of the house of God, and you and I are lively stones, living stones. We are a part, all of us are living stones, so to speak, in the body of Christ as we're born again. So he left his house, because where did he go? He went back to heaven. And what did he do? He gave authority to his servants and to every man his work. You've been given authority, and you and I have a work to do. Not only is there a walk that we must walk in, but there's a work that you and I must do. We saw that in Exodus 18, verse 20, when we talked about the must message recently, about what you must do. He's given authority to his servants and to every man his work. Your work is to work out your salvation. Your work is to conquer the enemies in your life. Your work is to use these prayers of authority to destroy the works of the enemy, not only in your life, but God's going to use you to affect other people's lives because you're going to be praying prayers of authority that are going to help conquer the enemy in their lives as well. So, God has given us authority. And what did Jesus come to do? Well, we see that 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Well, is he Jesus in us now? You better believe it. Is he wanting to do the same thing? Yes, he is, through you and me. And how does he say, well, Jesus is up in heaven. How's he going to do it? Through the name of Jesus that's been given to us, which is the delegated authority. Every time you speak in the name, he is doing it through you. It's like the power of attorney. Remember, you don't have authority in yourself. It's been given to you through Jesus Christ. So when you speak in the name of Jesus, it's like the power of attorney. If you gave me power of attorney, I would do something. You'd be actually operating through me, but I'm just a vessel. You and I are a vessel to release the authority through the name of Jesus as having the power of attorney to see Jesus do the works. That's why we do everything in the name of Jesus. So he goes, and he came to destroy the works of the devil, and he does the same thing. In fact, he wants us to do the very same works. He said, the works that I do, you'll do also. We're going to do the works. We're going to do the very same thing. Remember even what he said to those disciples in Matthew chapter 10. After he went forth, remember he was doing the works, and then he says to them, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you've received, freely give. You go forth and do the works, just like I was doing the works. The same works that he did, you and I are to do now. And how are we going to do this? We're going to do it through the mighty name of Jesus. We must understand, when you speak in the name of Jesus. You are bringing the kingdom, the rule and the reign of God into manifestation. Look what this says. Luke 11:10. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David, who cometh in the name of the Lord. What cometh in the name of the Lord? What comes in the name of the Lord? The kingdom. The rule and the reign comes into manifestation when you speak in the name of Jesus. We speak in the name of Jesus. We use the authority delegated to us, and we destroy the works of the enemy. This is why, when it talks about the signs that follow the believer after they're born again, the first sign listed is Mark 16:17. These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. In the name of Jesus, you're going to use the authority, and you're going to cast out the demons to destroy their works and drive them out. We see over in Matthew, in chapter 12, Jesus going forth, doing the works of God. In Matthew chapter 12, we see back here in verse 22, there was brought unto him one possessed with a devil, blind and dumb. Guy couldn't see, couldn't speak. He healed him, insomuch that the blind and the dumb both spake and saw. How did Jesus do it? He used the authority and destroyed the enemies by casting out the devils. All the people were amazed and said, is not this the son of David? Because they understood that the son of David was referring to the one who was going to be the king, because David was the king, and the Davidic covenant was not only made to David, but also to his seed, who was going to be Christ, and they were looking for his kingdom to come and manifest. Unfortunately, they thought it was a physical kingdom. They didn't realize that he said, my kingdom's not of this world, it's a spiritual kingdom. And of course, they did recognize who he was. The Pharisees heard it. They said, this fellow does not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. Otherwise, how did he get this guy free? He cast out the demons. They said, this guy's doing it by the devil's power. Oh, that's a bad thing to say. That's a big lie. Of course, Jesus comes along and he says, if Satan cast out Satan, he's divided against himself. Can Satan be casting out Satan? I don't think so. His kingdom will not stand. It's not going to work. If I, by Beelzebub, cast out devils, which is, of course, a lie, by whom do your children cast them out? So you mean they're doing it by Beelzebub? And they aren't going to say that, of course. Therefore, they shall be your judges. Now he tells them how he was doing it. If I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God, which is the rule and reign of God, is come unto you. That meant Jesus used the authority that was given to him to cast out the demons, and it brought the manifestation of the rule and the reign of God into manifestation in this guy's life. Now he wasn't blind anymore. Now he wasn't dumb anymore. He could see and he could speak as he destroyed the works of the enemy. God wants us to understand that you are going to do the mighty works of God and see the kingdom, the rule and the reign of God come into manifestation. You're going to do this through prayers of authority. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 even indicates the kingdom, which is now what we preach, the gospel of the kingdom. It's not just a watered down thing. It's not just getting born again, getting your ticket to heaven, and that's it. No. 1 Corinthians 4:20, the kingdom of God is not in word, but it's in power. Dunamis, it's going to manifest the power of God to destroy the works of the enemy. Well, that brings us to the place now. We've got to understand these prayers of authority then. We've been given authority. We got the name of Jesus. We got the weapons of warfare. Through the word, we understand how the kingdom works through what we're told to do, and these prayers of authority that we're going to pray are going to release the authority to destroy the works of the enemy. These areas are very important. Seven areas, seven prayers of authority that you must understand. The first one is to bind. You have authority to bind Satan, evil spirits, and to stop their works. Matthew 16:19 says, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. This is talking about two of the prayers. One of them is binding, and one of them is loosing. The word bind means to tie something up, or to stop it, or restrict it by legal authority. You stop its works. When you bind something, someone binds me up, then I'm tied up and I can't do anything. So binding is to tie something up and to stop it from working. Loosing is the opposite. It's to untie. I untie someone that's already bound, so now they're free. So you're going to use binding to tie up the enemy. You're going to use loosing to untie what the enemy has already done in a person or in a place. Now, we do have to talk about this verse because we have some problems in the translation. It says, I will give unto thee the keys. What are keys? Keys are means of access into something. I got keys that get me into the house or start the car or get you in the door or whatever it might be. They're means of access into something. The kingdom is the rule and the reign of something. So I have the means of access into the rule and reign of something. In the King James, it uses the word heaven three times, and it's singular. Unfortunately, that's not a good translation because it's plural in the Greek. It's not singular. It's plural. Because is this talking about in heaven where God is? No. Do we bind something on earth that's going to be bound in heaven? No. We're going to bind these spirits that are operating in the heavens. And who are we warring against? We come back here for a moment. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12 tells us this. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, spirits of wickedness in the high places. That's who we're warring against. These are evil spirits that are operating in the heavenlies. So these evil spirits that are operating in the heavenlies, we're going to be using weapons, spiritual warfare, prayers of authority to stop their works. The word heaven is plural. That makes all the difference in the world. Young's corrects it. I'll give to thee the keys of the reign of the heavens, plural. Bound in the heavens, loosed in the heavens. You see that last part where it said that? Well, you put Young's up here because it's a literal translation that brings things exactly. And if you want to see this, you may not know Greek, but this you can see some things. This is the Greek text, Scriveners, as the basis for the King James Version. When I put the cursor over this particular word, this is a word for heaven. Notice it is a noun. It is in the genitive case. It's masculine. And what is it? It is plural. It should have been translated heavens. Here's the second one. Noun, dative, masculine, plural. And then here's the third one. Noun, dative, masculine, plural. Should have been translated heavens. Well, that makes a big difference. I will give unto thee the keys, the means of access to the kingdom, the rule and the reign of the heavens. Who's been up there operating? Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness, and heavenly places are operating. Remember, there's three heavens. The heavens around the earth is where all these ones are operating. The mid-heaven is where the angels would fly between, going back from earth to the third heaven, which is where God dwells. So, we have the keys of the rule and the reign of the heavens. Whatsoever you shall bind on earth, where are we? On earth. Authority is released from you on earth. You've got to have a physical body to operate in authority. That's why Jesus is not doing it from heaven. Once you leave this place, you don't operate in this place any longer. You have to have a physical body, an earth suit, so to speak, to operate here. As that one who's born again, now you have authority. And you on earth can bind, tie up, and it's affecting that which is in the heavens. There's no distance in our prayers of authority. Now, what it says literally, whatsoever thou shalt bind, in fact, this shows that it's conditional upon you doing it, because it's actually a subjunctive mood verb. The way you would really translate this is, whatsoever you might bind on earth. I mean, it's conditional. You have to do it. If you don't do it, it's not going to get done. Whatsoever you might bind on earth shall be, the King James says, shall be bound in heaven. Now, just hold with me, because we're going to tell you something that's important to understand. At the same time, it looks like this that shall be bound should be all one verb, and it's just shall be or like helper verbs for bound, but it's not. The main verb here is the word be in this statement. It is, remember, we called told you the indicative mood is the mood of fact, a factual statement. Whatsoever you might bind on earth shall be. Well, what's bound then? Bound is not the main verb in here. It instead is a participle, which is like a verbal adjective. It's speaking something about what shall be, and that's going to be describing why that is so, or has some input into the main verb. Whatsoever you might bind on earth shall be. How do you translate a participle? Having been bound. It's a perfect tense, which is past participle. That's why Young's translates it outstanding. Whatsoever thou mayest bind upon the earth shall be, having been bound in the heavens. So what this is saying is, you have authority. You're going to speak to those principalities, powers, rulers of darkness and the heavenlies, and you can bind them. I bind you, spirits of lawlessness in the heavens, in the name of Jesus. From my position on earth, it took effect in the heavens. Now, who does the work in the heavens? We're not up in the heavens. Somebody's got to do the work. It's God's the one who does the work through the angels. Because the reason you know that is I put that word on bound. Remember, it was a perfect participle. It happens to be a passive voice. Now, again, we've given you a lot of Greek things tonight. I'm not trying to overwhelm you, but it is important to understand. There's three voices. An active voice means the subject doing the action. A middle voice means the subject is doing the action for himself, for his own benefit. The passive voice means the subject is being acted upon by somebody else. So, it's talking about that which I might bind on earth shall be, it's going to take effect in the heavens. Having been bound in the heavens, and who did the work? Not me, I'm not up there. The person who did the binding. It's happening by somebody else, and who's that? The angels. What do the angels do? Angels are carrying out what you and I speak forth that's in line with the Word of God. Psalms 103, verse 20 says, "Bless the Lord, ye angels that excel in strength, that do His commandments, hearkening unto the voice of His word." When you speak commanding words to bind those spirits, it shall be, having been bound in the heavens, because the angels are going to perform it, and they're going to go and do that work in the realm of the spirit against those evil spirits. The second one that we see right here as well is the exact same thing. Everything is the same. Shall be, having been loosed in the heavens. And this is untying something. I can untie evil spirits that are holding a person or a place, I can untie their hold from them so they can't keep them bound any longer. You and I have authority to do that. Also, what are we going to do that? We're going to also do something more. We're going to, which we'll jump into a third area. You and I have dominion in the realm of the Spirit. And Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 10 tells us something. He says, "See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms." You're in a position of authority. What are we going to do? We're going to root out, pull down, destroy, and throw down. That's all negative things. We're going to root out, pull down, destroy, throw down all these spirits' activities in the heavens, as well as to build and to plant the things of God as we speak things into being. See, we got to understand, you're in the kingdom. And you are now in a position as a king, and you're responsible to speak all these things into being, to release them to come to pass. So, well, I thought it was God who was going to do it all. I'm waiting for Him to do it. Everything operates through a person who has an earth suit, a physical body. He's given the authority to us. You've got to put it in operation or it doesn't get done. If you don't bind, it doesn't get bound. You and I are putting our authority in operation. So you and I have authority. What are we going to do? We're going to bind those spirits, tie them up. We're going to loosen, untie their hold. We're going to cast them down, throw them down, root them out, destroy, and eliminate them from where they are. We're not going to let them continue to operate. You and I have dominion. We must know this because God expects us to destroy the works of these spirits. Remember, we're wrestling against these spirits in the heavenlies, and we're going to destroy all of their works. The area of binding, one other thing we want to bring to your attention before we leave binding, is you're also going to bind spirits in people. Remember in Matthew 12:28, where it said, if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God's come unto you, how Jesus cast the demon out of him. Well, verse 29 says, or else how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, but he first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. The strong man is Satan. What is his house? The demons that are within us, the demonic network that's in us. How have they come into us? They've come in from inheritance, from the sins of the forefathers. They've come in from our own sins and our own life, giving place to the devil. And they could come in also by being victimized in life, what people use of the devil have done to you. Therefore, you and I are going to bind Satan, and then we're going to spoil or plunder his house. Which is what? The demonic network that's in us. How do we plunder his house? By casting the spirits out of us. You got to understand, Satan considers you his house through the spirits that are in you. We know that. Further down, when it talks about the spirit that got cast out of a guy, a unclean spirit, he's gone out of a man, he got cast out, walks through dry places seeking rest, finding none. He says, I will return to my house. What do the demons consider you? Their house. They want to come back into you. So demons in you consider you their house. They want to carry out their destructive work. They come to steal, kill, and destroy. They want to take away your health. They want to take away your peace of mind. They want to stop your prosperity. They want to stop your ministry. They want to hinder you. They want to disrupt you. They want to cause anxiety or fears or whatever, you'll give place to them. They want to cause arthritic pain. They want to cause cancer. They want to cause whatever they can, however they can get into you, they want to do things. So, the demons consider you their house. What are you and I to do? Remember what Jesus did? He cast the demons out. That's what you and I are going to do. We're going to spoil his house by casting out the demons and driving them out. So one of our prayers is a prayer of binding, which we bind them in the heavenlies to tie them up and stop their works. We bind them in people as a prerequisite before we cast them out. That simply ties them up so we can cast them out. We loose and untie them in the heavenlies, and you can also loose and untie them in people so that then you can cast them out as well. As well as one of the things that we do for loosing is over in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. The Bible says, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of those that believe not. They're blinded. The devil's got them blinded. So what are we going to do? We're going to loose and untie those blinders off of their minds, and we're going to command the light of the glorious gospel to shine into them, to bring light and bring revelation to them so that they'll come to the place of repentance. You can bind spirits in people, and you can loose and untie the effect of what those demons are doing in a person. Of course, those are not going to get rid of them. The way you get them out of a person is you've got to cast them out, and that is important. So we bind to tie them up. We loose to untie them. We cast them out to bring them out of a person. We cast them down, throw them down, destroy and root them out from the heavenlies. And the casting out is commanding these spirits to come out of us. And that's important. By the way, we want to cover a couple things about that. When you're casting the demons out, you continually command them to come out until they leave. Why? I thought they should just leave immediately. No, because demons have power and they're able to resist. Look what it says in Mark 1:25. Jesus rebuked him, saying, hold thy peace and come out of him. Looks like Jesus said it one time. Well, first of all, did the demon come out right away? No. The unclean spirit had torn him. It tore at him before it came out. Certainly wasn't obeying immediately. It was resisting. And he cried with a loud voice and came out of him. In Mark chapter 9, it was even worse. This shows you that demons can resist. They resisted Jesus. They were speaking to the dumb and deaf spirit. I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him. And the spirit cried and rent him sore. I mean, he went through a lot of fighting, being rent sore. That demon was, with his power, was resisting Jesus. Now, is that something you should expect yourself? No, this is like one out of a 10,000 cases or so. Most of the time, they come out real easy. But oftentimes, there can be times from times that they will cause pain or pressure or rent people sore or cause these kind of things. If they did it in the face of Jesus, that's just part of the warfare. We just have to keep casting them out until they're gone. Now, in talking about how we do this, remember we've already talked about praying without ceasing, continuously. Look at what Jesus did. It says he was saying, hold thy peace and come out of him. The question is, did he say it one time and then just wait until the demon came out? Or did he say it more than one time while the demon was resisting until he came out? How are we going to know? It looks like he said it one time, doesn't it? Well, the way you're going to know is by looking at the word saying. The word saying, when we put the cursor over it and we find out the tense voice and mood, we find out that it is the present tense. What does that tell us? Jesus rebuked him, saying and continuing to say to him, present tense, ongoing, hold that peace and come out of him, hold that peace and come out of him, hold that peace and come out of him. Why? Because he continued to release authority and power, authority and power, authority and power until that demon came out. It was the same thing in Mark chapter 9, verse 25, where he said, saying unto him, and here's the word saying, that's the critical word, how is he doing it? Did he say it one time? No. Present tense, ongoing, continuous action until he came out. The point being is that you're going to put your authority into operation and you're going to keep releasing that until you see the desired results. But in this case, would be continually casting it out until the demon comes out. So that's four of the areas. There's another one we want to look at in Mark chapter 11. Suppose you have something that's hindering you from being able to accomplish something. The devil's hindering you out there from getting some way spiritually to accomplish something. Otherwise, it's something on the outside that's blocking you, like a mountain. Mark 11, 23 says, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he'll have whatsoever he saith. This is a fifth area of putting a prayer of authority in operation. This is to move mountains or hindrances that are trying to block you on the outside and getting them out of the way. It's a mountain, it's not talking about a literal mountain, we're talking about a block, something that's trying to block you and get rid of that. Notice it says, you speak commanding words to it, you command it to be removed and be cast in the sea or cast out of the way. You can't be doubting in your heart or you won't get anywhere. You must be doing it in faith. And notice also, the question is, does he say it one time or he say it more than once? That is important because we've got to be sure that we're doing things right. Shall believe that those things which he saith, that's the important word. He's been saying to this thing, be thou removed, be thou cast in the sea. Now he's believing that those things which he saith, did he say it once or did he say it more than once? How do we know? We look up the tense. Again, present tense. Present tense. He's going to say it and continue to say to that mountain to be removed until it's removed. In other words, you keep applying your authority through your faith, which is putting the power of God in operation to see something be removed. So you believe that those things which you are saying and continuing to say, and by the way, there's another thing that's important here, not that it shall come to pass, but that it is coming to pass right then and there. The reason is because if it was shall come to pass, that would be a future tense verb. It is not. It is a present tense verb. The way you would translate this is you shall believe that those things which you are saying continuous and repeatedly are coming to pass. They are coming into manifestation. They are happening right then and there. And this is important. Every time you speak, whether you're casting out demons, whether you're speaking to a mountain, whatever it is you're speaking, you must know that what you are speaking is occurring. And it is something is happening at that point in time when you're speaking. Not that it shall later. No, you're having effect right then and there when you're speaking. And you need to understand and believe that those things you were saying, it is happening. You say, well, I don't see it. I didn't see the change yet. It's happening in the spirit. You got to win the battle in the spirit before you see the change in the natural. But you and I, everything we do is operate in the spirit. Because remember, this kingdom is a spiritual kingdom. And the authority is spiritual authority. And the power is spiritual power. And you're dealing with a spiritual enemy. And you're putting God into operation. The angels that are spirits, everything is spiritual. So you don't ever look at by your barometer, by what you see or what you feel, or the pain's not gone, or the problem's not gone, or I still have this situation. That doesn't mean that what you're doing is not effective. For instance, in casting out the demons, we cast out some of the demons. The pain's not gone yet. What does that mean? That means there's more to cast out until before you get it out. You keep casting it out, until it gets driven out. When it's all gone, it's eliminated. Otherwise, you keep putting your authority in operation until you see the results. Then you'll have whatsoever you say it. That's the removing the mountain. A sixth area is the area of remitting of sins. Why would we need to use this? It even says in John 20, verse 23, whosoever sins you remit, they're remitted unto them. Whosoever sins you retain, they're retained. You and I have authority to remit sins. Why would we remit sins? It's going to deal with the cause of a problem, because every curse has a cause, which is sin. And it's in order for us to deal with, we got to deal with the cause. And we do this especially in two ways, two things that are important to show you. But first of all, we'll talk about this in Luke 5:20. When he saw their faith, he said unto the man, thy sins are forgiven thee. This is the same word for remit. It's a phiemi. Now, when you see forgiven, you think New Testament today. Forgiven, cleansed, all gone, washed away. When was this said? When Jesus was walking on the earth in the Old Testament era. Was the New Testament in operation yet? No. So, when he's saying thy sins are forgiven, which is the word aphiemi, which means to send away. Your sins are sent away. That doesn't mean they were washed away, because nobody's sins were washed away until the blood of Jesus had been shed and the New Testament came into being. So what was he doing? He was remitting or sending away the effect of the man's sins. And what was that? Why was that important? Because that was the cause of why he was in the state he was in. He had a problem. Of course, he had physical ailment. And they said, who can forgive sins or remit sins, send away sins, but God alone? Jesus perceived their thoughts. He said, why reason in your heart? Whichever is to say, thy sins be sent away from you, remitted, or say, rise up and walk. He had authority to do both. He says, but you may know the Son of Man, remember, you and I can do everything that the Son of Man can, has power, what's this word? Exousia, we've seen it before, which means authority on earth. Jesus had authority on earth to remit sins, send away sins. You and I have authority to remit sins as well. Said to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise, take up thy couch, go into thy house. And of course, he immediately rose up. What did that tell him? This guy did have authority to remit sins, because they knew that sin was the reason why he was in his problem. Sin's the root of the sickness. So the sin got dealt with. So he remitted the sin, sent away the effect of them. Why is that important? We remit sins when we're doing intercession, and we also remit sins when we're dealing with inherited generational curses. Inherited generational curses come down the line that's affecting every single one of us, and that is important for you to understand. Many people out there in the body of Christ thought, well, I don't have any inherited curses. I'm born again. Not so. When you got born again, you got a new spirit, the spirit of Jesus Christ. But the curses, which are enforced by evil spirits that were in the soulish realm or in your body, were not eliminated. For instance, you got diabetes. You receive Jesus, you get born again. Praise God. Is your diabetes gone? No. You got a new spirit. You got problems in your mind with panic attacks. You get born again. Did all your panic attacks and all your problems go? No, they're still there in the soul and in the body. Notice what it says in Lamentations 5:7. Our fathers have sinned and are not, meaning they've passed on, and we have borne their iniquities. What is that? That's an inherited generational iniquity curse. And these curses come down the inheritance line. Numbers 14, verse 18 tells us something, that the iniquity of the fathers is visited upon the children to the third and fourth generation. That means that you and I and everybody on the face of the earth is affected by the sins of our fathers, parents, grandparents, great-grandparents, and even great-great-grandparents back three or four generations. That's why do you see cancer come down the line? Why do we see diabetes down the line, heart problems down the line, alcoholics down the line, anger problems down the line, you know, whatever. Mental problems down the line. Inherited generational iniquity curses, and they're affecting everybody, including Christians. What happens is we get born again, we get a brand new spirit now, it's right with God, now we're in a position of authority, now we can do something about all those spirits that came in from inheritance in our soul or body. We can cast them out and get free of all the inherited curses. Everybody has these. Now, in order to deal with the cause of the curse, and you must understand there is a cause for every curse, otherwise things just don't happen. There's a reason why they happen. Proverbs 6:2 says, 26:2 says, the curse causeless shall not come. What's that tell you? There's a cause for every curse, and a curse is a negative thing the devil brings. A blessing is a good thing that God brings. So there's a cause for it, which is sin. So what can I do about the sins of my forefathers? They've passed on, and I'm affected by them. Well, they can't confess them. You know, I'm just affected by them. So what can I do? God has given us authority to remit sins. I can remit the sins and iniquities of my forefathers and all the preceding generations that have influenced my life to break the legal right for those curses to continue to operate in my life. That hadn't gotten rid of it all. That just dealt with the cause. And then I can cast out the demons that have come in from it to get set free from the inherited generational curse affecting my life. We have authority. So use it in that area. Also, we can remit sins when we're praying for somebody else. Like you hear me do it all the time when I'm praying for this nation. I can't confess the sins for all the people who have done all the evil things and are continuing to do the evil things, but I got authority to remit sins. And I can remit the sins and iniquities of all the sins that have occurred in this nation, that have brought curses upon this nation, standing in the gap so that judgments don't come, and remitting those sins and speaking the word for God to forgive us of those sins and to bring forth a healing and of our land, speaking the word to release him to accomplish what he purposes, which of course is destroy the works of the enemy and see restoration. So you use this in intercession as well. Intercession is important. Then our last area is the area, the seventh one is the area of resisting the devil directly. James 4:7 says, submit yourselves therefore to God, according to his word, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Who's supposed to resist the devil? You and I are. So you're going to use your authority to resist the devil's temptations that are coming at you, or whatever he's coming at you with authority and the power through the word, and he's going to flee from you. We also see it in 1 Peter chapter 5. The first verse we gave talked about the devil being our adversary. Remember, he's our adversary as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. What are we to do? Verse 9 goes on and says, whom resist steadfast in the faith. You and I are to resist him steadfast in the faith. So, we can resist the devil, which will cause him to flee. And you're going to do that with your authority and with the word of God that you're going to speak to deal successfully with the temptations. Remember, when Jesus was being tempted, he had to deal with those temptations by speaking what the word was, so he chose the word instead of yielding to temptation. And he would told the devil to leave him, and he resisted the enemy using authority, and the devil would leave him. He didn't leave him right away. He had to keep on dealing with the temptations, but eventually he left him. If you'll resist the devil and you resist him steadfast in the faith, you don't stop until he leaves. You keep on resisting him, you have authority, and he will flee from you. So, we've seen these are prayers of authority that are mighty important. We got the prayer of binding to tie up the enemies, loosing to untie their hold, casting down, throwing down, rooting out from the heavenlies, stop them from continuing to work. To cast them out, to get them, all these evil spirits out of us so they're not in us any longer. To remit sins, which is sending forth the effects of that, which we do for breaking inherited curses, as well as interceding for others. To speak to mountains, to command them to be removed, that's anything that's trying to block you from the outside. You don't submit to that. You speak to that and command that to get out of your way in the name of Jesus. And then the resisting of the devil's temptations, where he's trying to get you to sin and get to come, have, give you a good place to him so he can come into you. You can resist all of his temptations. You and I have authority. As we put these prayers of authority in operation, we're going to see the power of God, the authority of God go into operation, and we can defeat every work of the enemy. Let's just give you an example. And we're going to kind of combine them all together. Let's say we're going to pray for a person, or pray for a person to be healed. And let's say that there's even some assignments against them from evil spirits in the heavens that are having effect upon them, causing their problem, as well as demons that are within them. Okay? I'm going to say, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that you have delivered me from the authority of darkness and you translated me into the kingdom of his dear Son, and you've given me authority over all the power of the enemy. And I bind every evil spirit that is assigned against and has effect upon this person causing this illness. Maybe it's a witchcraft curse from someone. I bind those spirits in the name of Jesus. I loose and untie their hold upon that person in the name of Jesus. I cast that thing down from having effect against him in the name of Jesus. I speak to those spirits that have come into him of sickness and disease or whatever it is, and I command them to come out of him in the name of Jesus. I also remit the sins and iniquities of his forefathers. Maybe part of this is from inherited generational. I remit those sins and iniquities of the forefathers that have brought this inherited generational thing into him, the spirits that are part of this whole problem. And so I'm also, let's say there's something out there is even trying to block him. I might speak to a mountain to be removed. And I'm also going to speak to resist any temptations that would maybe come against him, trying to get him to not take hold of the promise, trying to get doubt into him, trying to make him think that he can't receive healing from the Lord or something. So I'm going to use all those different prayers of authority. And I'm also going to pray a prayer, for healing. I'm going to say, Heavenly Father, your word says, himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses, and by his stripes we were healed. Therefore, I come boldly to the throne of grace, and I thank you that as I've spoken that scripture promise, I make a demand to what's due him, and I believe that I take hold of your healing power, and I thank you for your healing power, if let's say it's me, flowing into my body in the name of Jesus. And I'm speaking that into being, taking hold of it with my faith, thanking him, and I continue to speak that into being until the healing is manifest in my life. At the same time, I'm going to be continually casting out the demons until they're all gone as well. In other words, you're going to combine the prayers of authority with the prayers to take hold of promises and release a promise to come into manifestation in your life. And I'm going to pray continuously until I see desired results. So you want to find out some combination of whatever you need to do. Let's say I'm just praying for someone to be born again or to come to the place of repentance. I'd say, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you that you've given me authority over all the power of the enemy. And I thank you that your desire for this person to be born again, you want everybody to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. I bind those evil spirits that are in him, and I loose and untie the blinders off his mind. And I bind all the spirits that are assigned against him in the heavenlies, and I loose and tie your hold, and I cast you down and throw you down. Every mountain, everything that's trying to hinder him, I command it to be removed in the name of Jesus. I pray you, the Lord of the harvest, that you're sending forth the laborers that are going forth to minister the gospel. And I thank you for the word being sown in him, and I loose and untie the blinders off his mind. I command that light of the gospel shining into him through the laborers that are preaching it, to bring the revelation of Jesus Christ. And I thank you for opening the eyes of their understanding. I thank you for the Holy Spirit bringing him to the place of repentance, convicting him of the sin of not believing on Jesus. And I thank you for bringing him to the place where he calls upon the name of the Lord and receives Jesus and is born again. And I thank you for continually bringing the laborers to him and continually having that word sown into him until he comes to the place of repentance. And thank you for his salvation in Jesus' name. I'm combining all different kinds of things that I'm praying. Prayers of authority mixed together with speaking scriptures, speaking to bring things into manifestation. Notice that everything I'm doing something of a scripture to put the power of God in operation or to put what needs to come into this person in operation, such as the Holy Spirit convicting him of sin. That's out of John 16. I'm declaring the Holy Spirit, thank you for convicting him of the sin of not believing on Jesus. I'm just speaking what that scripture says the Holy Spirit will do. And as I'm speaking it, I'm releasing that to come to work, for the Holy Spirit to work, to bring him to the place of repentance. So that's what you're doing when you're praying. Don't waste your time praying the problem. Don't waste your time praying all these other things. Pray the scripture promise. Pray the word. Pray scriptures and link them together that release the power of God and deals with everything that needs to be dealt with to bring it into manifestation. You say, well, is that all? Then pray in tongues, because that's where you're going to pray for things you don't even know at all to pray for as we ought. Pray in tongues and you'll get all the rest of it. And you do that, and then whatever the Holy Spirit might show you, you just follow that and you learn to be led by the Holy Spirit in your prayer. And you release the power of God, and God is going to be working to bring forth what he purposes. And he will, because prayer releases him to accomplish his works. Say this with me. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that you have brought me into authority. And I thank you for these prayers of authority that I can pray that will release the authority and the power of God that will stop the works of the enemy, that will untie their hold, that will cast them down, that will cast them out, that will move mountains, that will resist the enemy, that will remit sins, stop all the works of the enemy. And I can pray prayers to you that will take hold of promises and speak things into being to bring forth your word to pass in that person's life. Thank you, Lord. I am going to pray prayers of authority, specifically for the situation I'm praying for, to release your authority and power to see you accomplish your will. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. You begin to do this, it's something you're going to learn as you begin to do it. You get the scriptures, you start praying the word, and start using your authority. And you're going to see God work mightily to bring forth what he purposes. Father, I thank you and praise you for all you brought forth. Thank you that we're learning accurate New Testament prayer. As we talked about prayers of authority this night, thank you that we're taking hold of this and we're going to put them in operation. And we're going to see great fruit come forth as we pray to release your mighty authority, power, and your promises. Thank you for much fruit as we hear and do this word. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God.